All right, I'll try and entertain you this evening. This is from the book. You should know that Bowman had been married once a long time ago. Then he had a long relationship with an English woman, and that ended. And he'd more or less given up the idea of getting married again, given up hope. He's in his 40s, but he feels it probably won't happen. Bowman had been in London for the book fair, and his flight home had been delayed. He landed in New York at 9 in the evening. It was half an hour before he had his bags and went out to get a cab. There was a crowd. He had to share a cab with someone also going to the West Side, a woman with three or four pieces of luggage. She moved her legs to give him more room. She was sitting back in what might have been a coat with the sleeves lying as if open. They rode in silence. Bowman was prepared to keep to himself, not looking at her again. In the city, strange women were not always as they appeared. There were women with grievances, disturbed women, women avidly seeking men. As they came to the expressway, she said, "Where are you coming from?" It was the way she said it. She almost seemed to know him. "London," he said, looking at her more closely for the first time. "And you?" "From Athens." "It's a long flight," he commented. "They're all long. I don't like to fly. I'm always afraid the plane is going to crash." "I don't think you should be afraid of crashing. It's quick. It's all over in a second." "Yes, it's what happens before that, when you know you're going to crash." "I suppose so, but how would you prefer to die?" "Some other way," she said. In the light from oncoming cars, he could see her dark hair and lipstick that made him take her for a Greek. The expressway paralleled Manhattan, which was like a long necklace of light across the river. At the far end was the financial district. And then from Midtown on up, the countless tall buildings, the great boxes of light, entire floors that never went dark. "You live in Athens?" he asked. "No," she said easily. "I was taking my daughter to visit her father." "I've never been to Greece." "Pity. It's a marvelous country. When you go, go to the islands." "Anyone in particular?" "Oh, there's so many," she said. "There are places that time seems never to have touched, absolutely unspoiled." They looked at one another without speaking. He didn't know what she might be seeing. She had clear, smooth features. "The people have something you don't find here," she said. "They have a joy of life." "That's nonsense," he said. She ignored it. "Were you in London on business?" "Yes, business, the London Book Fair." "Are you a publisher?" "No, not really, I'm an editor. A publisher has different responsibilities." "What sort of books do you edit?" "Oh, mainly novels," he said. "The friend I'm staying with was in a novel. She's rather proud of it. Eve was her name in the book." "That's not her name." "Which book is that?" "Oh, you know, I forget the title. I only read the parts about her. She knew the author." "So, tell me your name," she said after a pause. Her own name was Christine Vassilaros. She was not Greek. She was married to a Greek man, a businessman, from whom she had separated. Her friend, Kennedy, the one who'd been written about, was also separated, but still living in a rent-controlled apartment that was a relic of grand life before the two world wars and the time between them. "I'm not giving up the apartment," she had said. It was like an apartment in Havana, large and only sparsely furnished on 85th Street. They arrived at Bowman Street first. He handed her a little more than half the fare. "It's very nice of you to share the cab," he said. "Can I call you sometime?" he impulsively asked. She wrote down a telephone number on the back of an airline stub. "Here," she said. She pressed it in his hand. As the cab left, he had an exalted feeling. The taillights going down the street, bearing her away. It had been like theater, a glorious first act. The doorman greeted him. "Good evening, sir." "Yes, good evening." "I met the most wonderful woman," he wanted to say. He'd met her by chance. He thought about it excitedly while going upstairs and then in the apartment. She was married, she had said. But that was understandable. At a certain point in life, it seems everyone was. At a certain point also, you began to feel that you knew everyone. There was no one new. And you were going to spend the rest of your life among familiar people. Women, especially. It was not that she had been friendly. It was that, but more. He felt like trying the telephone number, but that was foolish. She wouldn't even have arrived at her street yet. He was already impatient. He must somehow not seem it. When she came to lunch a day later, he knew it was all in vain. She was younger than he thought, but he could not be sure. They sat facing one another. She had the neck of a woman of 20, and her face had only the faintest lines from expressions, from her smile. There was almost a physical thrill to her. He didn't want to succumb to it, but he was unable to prevent it. Her bare neck and arms. She was certainly aware of it. "Don't become intoxicated," she seemed to say. He could look at her so closely. Her gleaming dark hair, her upper lip was arched. She held her fork with a kind of languor, as if ready to discard it. But she ate with generous mouthfuls as she talked, not diverted from the food. Her other hand was raised, half closed, as if drying her nails. Long, disdainful fingers. It turned out she had lived in New York, on Waverly Place, she and her husband, for a number of years. 6, she said. She'd worked as a broker. He was looking at her. You wanted to watch her. "It's beautiful," she said. "That's a nice part of the city." "You know New York then," he said, feeling jealous. "Very well." She didn't say much more or much about her husband. She was evasive. His business was in Athens, that was all. They'd been living in Europe. "In Athens?" "Yeah, we're separated." "Are you still on good terms?" "Well, intimate terms," he found himself asking. She smiled. "Hardly," she said. He felt he could say anything to her, tell her anything. There was a kind of complicity, even if nascent, between them. "How old is your daughter?" he asked. She was 15. He was astonished to hear that. 15? You don't look as if you could have a 15-year-old daughter. he said, and added casually, "How old are you?" She made a slight disapproving expression. 32? "I was born during the war," she said. "Not at the beginning of it," she added. He was aware then of his own age, but she didn't bother to ask it. Her daughter's name was Annette. "How is that spelled?" he said. "It's a beautiful name." "She's a marvelous girl. I'm mad about her," she said. "Well, your daughter, it's not just that. Do you have children?" "No," he said. He almost felt he'd fallen short in her eyes. He was visibly older. He was visibly older, he knew. He was single. He had no family. "That's a very nice name," he repeated. "Some names are like magic, unforgettable." "That's true. Vronsky," he said as an example. "Vronsky? Not a very good name for a girl." "No, of course not. Unforgettable, but not good. I'd almost have another child just to name it." "If you were to have a child, what would you name it?" she asked. "Well, that's something I've never really thought about. If it was a boy, yes. If it was a boy, Agamemnon." "Ah, yes," she said, "of course. Achilles is a good name, too. Agamemnon sounds a little more like a horse." "He'd be a wonderful boy," Bowman argued. "I'm sure he'd be. With a name like that, he'd have to be." "And what would you name a girl?" "I'm almost afraid to ask." "A girl?" "Kiskaya," he said. "I see you're a traditionalist. What was that name again?" "Kiskaya. Must be some figure in history or a novel. It's a Peruvian name." "Peruvian? Really?" "No, I made that up," he confessed. "Anyway, it goes very well with Bowman." "Kiskaya Bowman," he said. "Well, let's just keep it in mind. Yeah, and her sister, Vronsky." "Yes. All right. Become intoxicated." It was always from the first word, the first look, the first embrace, the first fatal dance. It was there waiting. "Christine, I know you," he thought. She was smiling at him. He had to tell someone afterwards. He had to say it. It was simply bursting from him. He said to the doorman, "I met the most wonderful woman." "Oh yeah? Good for you, Phil." He never called him by his first name before, although they sometimes chatted. His name was Victor. "You'll meet her," Bowman felt like saying, but realized how man about town it sounded. And also, he did not know if it would happen. He might have regretted saying anything, but he hadn't been able to help it. The apartment looked bright, welcoming. It was her presence, her initial presence in his life. They went to a dinner party given by a husband and wife who published art books, a branch of publishing all to itself, art books and also large format books on architecture and even more particular subjects, hotels of the Amazon, things like that. Jorge and Felice Arsenault. It was she who had the money. There were eight at the table, including a young French journalist and a biographer who was writing a life of Apollinaire. The poet had been badly wounded in the First War. Christine was perfect, her looks, of course. They were certainly very conscious of her, and she was graceful and did not say much. She didn't know any of them and didn't force herself on them. The biographer, who had been working on the book for years, once had the chance to actually meet Apollinaire's old mistress, not the one who threw herself out of a window when Apollinaire died, but another one, who was Russian. Apollinaire had written about her in a poem. I was thrilled to be able to meet her. I mentioned the poem, of course. She was old by then. You know what she said? She said, "Oui, je mourrai en beauté. I'll be beautiful until I die. I'll die beautiful." You can't translate it exactly. "When I die, I'll still be beautiful," something like that. From this, they began talking about dying and then heaven. "I don't like the idea of heaven," the hostess said. "For one thing, the people would be going there. There's no such thing as heaven anyway." "Are you certain?" someone said. "Certain enough. And if I'm wrong, well, you might as well sin on earth. There's not going to be any of that in heaven." "Are you married?" the biographer asked Bowman and Christine. "No, not quite," Bowman said, to finish more interest on the biographer's part. He had not been thinking of marriage, but of everything that might lead up to it. He had been thinking ceaselessly of Christine. He knew he would have to do something ordinary, asking her up to the apartment for a drink or a nightcap. The word seemed old-fashioned, even preposterous. He was certain she liked him, but at the same time, he was nervous about putting it to the test. He hated the idea of being awkward. At the same time, he knew it to be unimportant, that once they were past that, anything awkward would be forgiven. But it didn't matter what he knew, or else he'd forgotten all he knew. The journalist was telling the story of a notorious murder. It wasn't clear where it had happened. It was solved because of traces of semen. He pronounced it semen, found on a cigarette. He managed to repeat the word several times. No one bothered to correct him. As they left the table, Christine said in a low voice, "Semen?" "Must be the French pronunciation," Bowman said. "Seminé," she suggested. "Now that's the title of a song." "I'll try some," she remarked, as if they were talking about an odd menu item. She added, "Do you happen to have any?" Was she still kidding? She was not looking at him. "Yes," he said. "Lots."
Mr. Salter, my name's Mark Donnelly. I teach English here, and I just finished reading the book, All That Is. I thought it was quite good. You start the book, the character Phil Bowman is in the Pacific, and the invasion of Okinawa. Read pretty realistically. What kind of research did you do for that?
Well, I mean, I wasn't at that battle.
Right.
I've been in that part of the world.
Mm-hmm.
And I've heard stories from naval officers frequently over the years, not about that specific battle, but enough. And I assembled it, and of course I read about it. That goes without saying. So I assembled it from that.
Right. That was good. It was a very good introduction, too.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm curious about your writing process, whether you come up with something, with an idea or a theme, and you start adhering all the scenes to that, or do you start developing something as you go along?
Let me see if I understand your question. Do I have the scenes all laid out in advance.
Right.
Or do as they arrive.
Right.
I am inspired to create
right.
them. Yes. I usually do an outline for a book.
Uh-huh.
I like to know where it begins and where it ends, and have the course of the book laid out. And from that, I work from that. And of course, you have to allow for variations that impose themselves for one reason or another. It didn't work out. You were unable to write what you felt you had to write, or you wrote it and it turned out it was wrong for that. The book should not go that way. So the answer is yes, I have a compass and a map, but I get lost occasionally.
Thank you.
Well, let me speak about myself rather than in generalities. I was influenced by certain writers. I began trying to write the way they had written. And after a while, two things happen. You find out that you are merely imitating somebody in your writing, and it's not as good as the original. It's not as authentic as the original, and nor is it regarded with, as seriously as the original. And also, simultaneously with that, you're finding your own way of speaking or writing. And and that happens eventually, I think, to everyone, sometimes sooner, sometimes a little later. But you're definitely aware. Well, normally you don't read important writers while you're writing, because they are influential. It's like trying to sing when somebody's singing another song. You can't hear yourself, you can't carry the tune. It's confusing. So you try and keep your head clear.
You were in the Air Force, correct? Did you always know that you wanted to write when you were serving in the military? And what was the transition like from going from something with so much structure to something so unstructured, lifestyle-wise?
I think you've expressed it. I mean, you go from a very ordered... Well, it's like having a job. Having a job saying, I'm going to quit my job. I'm going to write all the time now. The first thing that happens is you say to yourself, I'm supposed to be writing all the time. Here quickly get a guilty conscience, because you can work 8 hours a day, but normally you can't write hours. Writing is unproductive compared to other jobs. And the military is especially organized, not only in terms of work, but in terms of the whole social, in terms of the entire life. So all that's pitched out, and you just say it's like being in a lifeboat. The ship sank, now you're in the boat by yourself. Let's see what happens.
When you were serving, did you know that you wanted to write?
Oh, well, I knew I wanted to write for a long time, long before the service. I mean, when I was a schoolboy, I thought vaguely of wanting to write, and I wrote a little in school. I mean, the usual quality of stuff. And I tried to write, self-taught, a novel, actually two. And I had, you know, I. It's hard to believe now, but you don't know how it's done. Seems obvious, but when you're put to doing it yourself, it becomes mysterious. So finally what happened is, on the third try, it happened to be a subject and a story that were available to me, completely available, and that time I was able to do it. That was all doing it, that is to say, in the evening. I was still an officer in the Air Force. But while that, at the same time, I was writing a book, that horrible thing, writing a book. Very suspicious act in the service. Well, burning the days took a long time because, first of all, it wasn't my idea. I was urged to write it, and then I didn't know whether I wanted to continue writing it. My editor suggested it in the first place on account of an article I had written, so that made it take longer to write. And also, I adopted the idea that I wanted it to be as accurate as I could make it in simple factual terms, what that place looked like, who that was, what they had done, all that business. So there was a lot of research involved, going back, looking at journal, traveling to places, talking to people. It was a simple job of nonfiction. And was it any different to write? Not particularly. in some respects, easier, because I had it all laid out. It was merely the writing of it that had to be done.
I have two questions. One related to the present novel. The description of an early character in the book that Bowman is in college with, I think his name is Paulson or Michelson.
His roommate?
Yes, roommate.
I forget his name at the moment.
When you describe how he is in casual dress after college, it's a very similar description to the way you describe a later character, Eddins, and his casual dress in upstate. And I wondered if you were, if that was conscious or not.
No, unintentional. But sometimes you do find two people who dress in similar style.
Right.
They're not exactly the same. I would say Malcolm, I think his name was, is more rich and eccentric. Eddins is more working class and sincere, that is to say, that's the way you dress.
Right, and that the difference in the characters, I certainly got that in the book, particularly Eddins, because he's a key character.
A beaut, did you say?
A key, he's very key, a key character in the book.
Yes.
My other question is, I noticed in the bio that's provided by St. Francis College that you had written screenplays for Robert Redford, and in an interview in the current Men's Journal, with Robert Redford's on the cover, he mentions you in the article and talks about unfortunately had lost contact with you. I wondered what screenplays you had written for Robert Redford.
Well, the only one that was produced was A Downhill Racer.
Oh, great. Great movie.
And yes, we lost contact. He became a star.
Thank you.
Well, what do you think?
Any other questions? Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks.